Between the mud and the snow, Russia gave us ice. And in the ice, my God, that Tiger was a heavy lump of iron to drive. 60 tons of the Reich's finest metal, fitted with the widest tracks ever designed. But still, in that frozen Russia, the Verdam beast would slither and claw its way around, with me riding its gears like a boy riding a dragon. It was bad enough in the assembly area that morning, as our company of 20 Tiger I Panzers came in from their concealment points and began to form up before dawn, with their exhausts sparking flames and their great dish wheels throwing out icicles 1 meter long. But when we heard the order, "Panzer Marsch," and we surged out to form up into our arrowhead, with our lead tank at the tip of the arrow, and the others in a flying V-shape behind him, our 20 80-10 Elitum guns pointing at the heart of the red zone, that was when it got tough for this humble panzer driver. We were advancing east across 3 kilometres of steppe, right into the Ivan Army's flank, heading for a line of red bunkers on higher ground that we had to destroy. 3 kilometres of freezing tundra, filled with bomb craters, other destroyed tanks and the little tricks that the Reds like to play on us German boys. If our Tiger slid through the mist into one of those craters, with deep water under the crust of ice, then our Panzer would become a U-boat. If our vehicle collided with one of the wrecked T-34s still smouldering from the previous day's combat, then we might detonate their ammunition or damage our precious track links. And if we ran into one of Ivan's special traps, the anti-tank ditch concealed with straw, or the flamethrower that ignited when a Panzer rolled over a cable, then we'd breathe our last gulp of Russian air if we were lucky. The less fortunate might survive and take the prison wagon to Siberia. Peering through my armoured vision slit at the step out in front and following my commander's instructions from up in the turret cupola, I dreaded any of these things happening to our Tiger. Despite our armour plate, I had the sweating hands and dry throat that always came from facing the big red war machine. In the east, the winter sun began to rise like a piece of hot iron, but it gave no warmth to the landscape, which stayed shrouded in low mist and drifts of ice. Overhead, 3 of our Fokker Wolf fighters streaked forward, trailing vapour, and then a slow, lumbering flight of 6 Stukas heading out to soften up those Ivan bunkers for our Tigers to maul. Inside our Panzer, it was humid now, as the groaning transmission became hot and warmed the sealed-in air. Condensation collected on my dials. Scalding oil from the transmission spat on my face. The reek of carbon monoxide made my head throb, and I almost envied our commander up in the turret, still with his head up in the morning air, despite the risk he ran of losing that clever brain to a shell or a sniper. "What a stench," the gruff voice next to me muttered. "If they could bottle this cologne for me to wear, I won't be troubled by so many blondes on my next leave in Hamburg." Our radio operator and hull machine gunner, Kurt, was the ugliest man in the Heavy Panzer Battalion, and my best comrade. I didn't have to look at him over the shuddering transmission housing to know he was sighting down the eyepiece of his MG-34 and monitoring the signals from our other panzers with his great deformed ears in his headphones. In front of us, the line of Tigers on our side of the surging arrowhead sprayed up plumes of mud and ice into the reddening sky, maintaining a steady 20 kph that allowed us to stay in formation and make good time across the no-man's steppe. The ground ahead was barren, with just the hulk of another burned-out T-34 between us and the ridge in the distance where the target bunkers were sighted. Up there I could see the crooked black shapes of the Stukas peeling and diving out of the dawn sky, diving almost vertically. And as I watched, great spouts of debris shot up as their bombs exploded on the Ivan forts. I wiped my sweating forehead on my sleeve and glanced around momentarily at the base of the turret cage. I saw 3 pairs of feet in there, the scuffed lace-up boots of our 80 Imitira gunner and our loader, and the polished jack boots of Oberleutnant Hellmann, our vehicle commander. The shine on those boots was legendary, like Hellmann's coolness in action, his taste for cognac and his hatred of the Reds. I glanced back at my vision slit and made a slight change to the differential, steering us around the wrecked T-34. The Ivan tank was a blackened hulk, surrounded by debris, with its tracks hanging off and its gun pointing down. I blinked as I looked at that T-34. It was perhaps 200 metres away, outlined against the skyline. And through the mist on my vision block, I thought I saw the Vadam thing moving its gun. "What the scheisse?" Kurt grunted beside me. "That Ivan is moving." I wasn't sure what I was seeing. This smashed, burned tank, with its tracks lying in spools on the step around it, was elevating its 76mm gun, and its turret was traversing onto us. What the hell was going on here? "Fire on the red!" Hellman shouted over the headphones. The order was to our gunner, who lived with his face glued to the eyepiece of the gun sight. "Fire on him!" I heard our turret traverse with its drive motor as our gunner calibrated on the T-34, which now had its barrel pointed at our whole flank of 10 panzers, aiming at hull sides where our armour was comparatively thinner. Our other Tigers were traversing onto him too. All the crews had observed that this hulk was apparently coming to life. That T-34 got off one single shot before he was blown to pieces. His muzzle flashed and spat fire. And at the same moment, he was hit by half a dozen armour-piercing shells from the Tiger muzzle brakes that spat, smoked and recoiled in unison at the intruder. In our turret, the huge gun barked, and the shell case sprang out with a clang. Two things happened straight away. First, the T-34 disintegrated as the broadside of 84 centimetre shells smashed into its armour at zero range. The turret split open, and for a moment I saw a man in there, a single gunner, twisting as his carapace was blown apart. Then he too disappeared as the hull below him was demolished, with the deck separating from the walls and the sloped glacis plate breaking into pieces that span away in the air like bits of a tin can. His ammunition in there exploded, and the mangled turret ring gave out a blast of sparks and flames that rose high above our column. A beacon of success. But at the same time, I saw that the Tiger, at the very tip of our spearhead, our leading panzer, was shuddering and throwing out metal treads from its tracks. Suddenly, its whole track on the right side came flying out backwards, thrashing in the wake of the rear idler wheel like a horsewhip. Track links broke off and hit the following panzers. Then the damaged Tiger slowed down in a spray of mud and juddered to a halt. "That red rascal's hit the boss," Hellman said coolly over the headphones. "The boss is stranded here now, the poor soul." "Shall I halt, sir?" I asked over the intercom. "No panzer can halt," Hellman replied. "These are our orders." The boss was our commander, our Hauptmann, who had led the unit since the glory days of Barbarossa. Now Hellman, as his second in command, would automatically take over the leader's role. Kurt winked at me over the bulkhead separating us. To lead the heavy panzer unit into an attack, that was always Hellman's wish, and now he had it. The boss's damaged panzer remained stranded, while the following Tigers moved around it without slowing or losing formation. Briefly, I saw the immobilized Tiger as we went past it, with its track blown off by that single shell from the T-34 before the Russian was destroyed. The static Tiger's crew were starting to clamber from their hatches to assess the damage, but we could all see that the track was smashed, and the vehicle would be unable to move without a recovery panzer to bring a whole new length of track links. "Maybe that's a bad omen," Kurt muttered beside me, changing his mood. "How did that wrecked Ivan manage to take a shot?" "Such is the Red Army," Hellman said without emotion, speaking from the turret through our headphones. "They find a gunner who's made some mistake. They tell him his family will go to Siberia unless he dies a hero's death, and they put him in a wrecked tank that still has a halfway working gun. They tow it out here at night and dump it, with him inside and a few shells." "That's how it works, is it?" Kurt said into the intercom. "If I was him, I'd jump out and hand myself over to good German hospitality." "Ah, but they put a padlock on the hatches," Hellman said, "and they tell him to think of his lovely wife who won't enjoy the Arctic Circle. Now enough of talking, and let's watch for any more of these red games. We are close to the target here." "The boss, sir," I said. "He'll be okay, Faust. Keep driving." I had no time to reflect on what chance our stranded boss and his crew had of surviving in the steppe. We all knew that the disputed tundra held Red infantry fighters hidden in lairs, who would begin to emerge and prowl around any immobilized panzer. But at that point, we had our own battle to fight. Ahead of us, the diving Stukas had left vertical trails in the freezing air that still remained sharp, like twists of steel wire against the dawn. They pointed downward to the fires, and clouds of dust where their bombs had struck, pulverizing the red bunkers and blockhouses that we were now to attack, to crush and overrun. We knew, though, that the Reds were at their most vicious when they'd taken a beating, like surly red dogs, Hellman often said. We were about 1,500 metres from the enemy bunkers, close enough to see the smoke drifting from the Stuka bomb craters. I was feeling jumpy, as I so often did in action, as each minute seemed to stretch out interminably, every second full of the threat of a mine under the tracks, or a heavy calibre pack round smashing through the bulkhead beside my head. The stench of the Tiger's compartment was overlaid with the bitter scent of the 88mm blast. I wished the waiting was over, and we could start firing or manoeuvring or anything other than this slow, onward advance under the eyes of the watching Reds. The waiting ended when the smoke around the bunkers parted, and a stream of T-34 tanks came pouring out to face us. I laughed with a weird relief, and beside me, big, ugly Kurt did the same, hunched over his MG-34 stock, moving the ball mount left and right across the ground ahead. Through my headphones, I heard the rapid discussion between Hellman and our gunner, and I heard the loader grunting as he seized another round of armour-piercing in readiness. Then the orders came fast and furious as the Russian tanks charged towards us across the wretched steppe of their homeland. Even through the specks of mud on my vision block, I could see that these were the upgraded type of T-34s, with enlarged turrets and the long 85mm gun they carried to deal with us dashing lads in our Tigers. Their hulls were thinner than ours, though, and against our high-velocity 88mm warheads, any kind of strike from us was a danger to them. Their only hope was to get close enough to make their guns count, and this was their tactic, setting their thicker front plates towards us and accelerating, with their bulbous turret fronts leaning forwards. Like dogs, Hellman muttered, using his favourite metaphor. Like a pack of dogs. His voice was drowned out as our 80mm mit and fired, and the Tiger flattened down in its motion as the breech recoiled. Smoke from the muzzle breech clouded my vision momentarily, and when that cleared, I saw our Tigers spreading out from their arrowhead, moving into a broad arc that stretched for a kilometre left and right across the plain. I moved our Tiger into the line, being roughly in the centre, and aimed our Panzer for the Russian bunker line that we had to smash through. I saw one of these T-34s, barely a kilometre away now, explode on first contact with our ordnance, the turret lifting up into the air and spinning over repeatedly, scattering the burning remains of the gun crew behind it. The hull itself flashed and blew up in a blaze of fuel. I focused on a little pack of three red tanks that was advancing in our direction, with mud flying around them as they charged towards the centre of our line. "Slow down," Hellman told me. "Steady the gun on this uneven ground, man." I went down to 10 kph, so the rolling terrain would have less effect on the accuracy of the gun. The split second between our gunner pulling his trigger and the shell leaving the muzzle was now made more stable, but of course we were a slower, easier target. We had to trust in the 10 scimitars of steel on our front hull and the 12 scimitars on our turret. The Tigers beside us slowed similarly, and together we in the centre of the line fired repeatedly on the advancing Russian armour. That pack of three T-34s took the brunt of our guns immediately, as lines of our bright red tracer shot towards the MI saw one of the red machines take a hit on his front plate, which made the whole tank bounce and recoil, as a spray of metal pieces erupted from his armour. Another round hit him in the gun mantle, and the turret jerked to one side at the blow, but the 80mm round deflected off and went spinning wildly across the steppe. A third round pierced him between the turret and hull, and the whole gun mantle exploded off, leaving a gaping hole which gushed with sparks. Defenceless, the tank tried to turn to flee, but as its panicking driver slewed to one side, he presented his thinner hull flank and paid the price for his mistake as another line of tracer penetrated the crew compartment there. I saw the wrecked turret spurt a plume of flames from the broken mantle and the turret hatch, and the whole vehicle span around on its axis, out of control, pouring with fire. I did not spare any emotion for the burning crew boys. My simple mind, trained in the back streets of Munich to watch for danger, turned attention to the other two T-34s, who were now halted in a spray of mud some 500 metres from me. Their muzzles flashed, and I saw green tracer race towards us. There was a crash from in front of me, and the electric light over my head exploded, showering me with fragments. My transmission raced for a moment, slipping the gears, and then I got the beast under control and prevented it sliding sideways onto the enemy. We were hit on the front plate beside my head, between Kurt and me, but the great Tiger kept on rolling slowly forward, and our 82 Mittitus kept booming out from the turret behind me. Through the mist of blast gas, oil fumes and exhaust in our hull, I saw in my vision slit the tank that had just fired being hit in the right-hand track, which flew up into the air, dragging with it the steel drive wheel. Crippled, it tried to reverse, but it simply dug a grave for itself with its running track, which raced around and sank deep into the mud. Its gun kept on firing, and the Tiger beside us was hit on the turret in a shower of sparks, until one of our shells punched into the T-34's bow, close to its smashed front wheels, and split open the armour plate. We advanced as that tank began to burn, and its crew began to emerge from the hatches to escape the flames. Next to me, the compartment echoed as Kurt loosed off 2 seconds from his gimbal-mounted MG-34, catching the Russians as they clambered out onto the hull and turret. He cut them down, then ceased fire, breathing hard and cursing to himself. I never knew if he liked the killing or if he hated it. The third of these T-34s that we were facing in our section now began to reverse, firing wildly as it went back, throwing up a curtain of black mud, ice and debris from its wide tracks. Indeed, as I glanced left and right along our line, I could just make out that the T-34s were generally retreating from us, although one of our Tigers had been set on fire and was burning with a crimson glow around its engine deck. I saw the shapes of maybe 5 of the Russian tanks, burning or pouring smoke, one with its turret shot away and another lying on its side with its track still turning slowly in the air. I began to think that success was upon us. Ahead, behind the retreating T-34s, pursued as they were by our angry tracer rounds, the bunker line stood smashed and burning against the ridge of higher ground that it was supposed to defend. Ahead of me, I suddenly saw the retreating T-34 grind to a halt and face Ostfront, its muzzle shooting 3 rounds in rapid succession along our line. There was a colossal crash as we were hit in the turret, causing a shrieked curse from our loader and a grim chuckle from Hellman. In response, our cool gunner put an 88mm shell straight into the halted tank's frontal plate. The round blew off the driver's vision block armour in a starburst of debris. But still, the T-34 remained defiant. "Ah, I see why," Hellman muttered, and I heard his polished boots click behind me on the floor of the turret cage as he moved around, checking the view from the radial periscopes in his cupola. "I see. There's an anti-tank ditch behind that Ivan tank. It's deep too. It goes all along our line. Verdamm." I brought the Tiger to a halt, and along our row of panzers, the other Tigers stopped or slowed as their commanders too realised the danger. From my hull position, I couldn't see the ditch. I could only see the T-34 still firing at us. But if it was like the other Ivan ditches, it was 4 metres deep and the same wide, just enough to trap a magnificent Tiger and its handsome German crew by toppling it nose down into the Russian depths. Sometimes these ditches contained mines or aircraft bombs, which were rigged to explode when a panzer fell in. Others were filled with pools of gasoline, which were primed to detonate, incinerating the trapped vehicle. I had seen some of these ditches that had been dug by German prisoners, with the bodies of our men still strewn in the pit, dead where they laboured and dug. And of course, our own anti-tank ditches were full of dead Soviet prisoners who were worked to death likewise. This was Russia. Hellman swore long and hard at this obstruction, his boot soles scraping around behind me as he studied the situation. Then his cursing turned to a crescendo and he yelled, "Hull gunner, where are your eyes, man? The Reds are in front of you." In justice to Kurt, I could not see the problem either. Being low down and right at the front, our vision apertures were coated with mud and ice, and the sighting glass on the bow MG-34 was notoriously prone to become obscured. But then Kurt grunted viciously, hunched over, and began firing his MG-34 in long bursts, moving his shoulders around frantically as he aimed at the targets he saw. In front of my block, I suddenly witnessed a lone Red soldier, in a fur cap and quilted jacket, appear from a hole in the ground barely 20 metres away, throwing back a straw cover and vaulting out onto the step, followed by another Ivan doing the same. In moments, the ground in front of us was dotted with these brown scarecrows, all of them dodging and weaving between our MG tracer as they battled to get close to our panzers. I feared these devils more than I feared a T-34. These Red Army anti-tank infantry lived and breathed for killing tigers. They fought with handmines, satchel bombs, and even Molotov bottles thrown onto the fan grills of our engine decks. It took just one of them to get close, to throw his bomb, and our engine would suck in fire or fragments through the rear grills, setting off our oil and gasoline and bringing our Wehrmacht careers to a fiery conclusion. Kurt was doing what he could, hosing down the ground with MG fire, giving the Reds no chance to approach, and the Tiger on our left was blasting away, lowering its main gun too so that the coaxial MG could aim at the ground, and traversing left and right to keep up a murderous semicircle of bullets. All the time, though, that T-34 behind the emerging infantry was shooting at us, and I felt the Tiger rock as we took hit after hit on our turret and bow plate. One of the T-34's shells actually saved our necks. It deflected off our bow and flew straight back in a burst of metal scabs. The spinning warhead tore into a Russian soldier as he was running towards us, carrying a mine, crouched down low. The shell decapitated him and then hit the belly of the man behind him. Both bodies kept running towards us for a moment until they slumped down. They exploded as their mines detonated, sending their severed limbs flailing across the ground. Our gunner silenced that Verdam Ivan tank with two shots, one through the driver's visor, and another that tore off its left track and wheels, sending bits of the drive wheel into the air for hundreds of metres. That tank began to smoulder, the barrel slumped, and our gunner immediately lowered our main gun and began spraying MG onto the infantry, as our comrade Panzer beside us was doing. Beside me, my big, ugly Kurt fired MG until his ammunition cylinder gave out, and then he began to change it with a suitable muttered commentary, referring to the generally inefficient designs of the Spandau gunsmiths in terms of magazine capacity. In the pause, the Red infantry surged forward from the right-hand side, these mud-covered creatures that I could just see in the corner of my glass block, grinning and shouting with their wild eyes fixed on our superb panzer. It was a desperate moment, and I took desperate measures to protect us. Normally, a panzer did not like to approach enemy foot soldiers armied with hand bombs. The risks were too high, and our engine grilles were too vulnerable. But now I got close to these Red rascals, close enough to give them a view of our dish wheels and steel track links working in unison. With a shout of encouragement from Hellman, I threw the Tiger into gear. My right hand forward and my left hand pulling back on the differential wheel, I span it 60 tons around on its axis so that the churning wheels and tracks rotated in a circle towards the onrushing Red troops. I didn't even feel their bodies being crushed and chewed by the tracks. There wasn't even a jolt as we ran them down in clusters. Human flesh was too soft to withstand these forces, too frail to even register on my dials. I saw three of the Ivans try to run in front of my vision slit, until the square hull front covered them up and only a dismembered leg in its felt boot tumbled up onto our glacis. I span and crushed the enemies down, with Kurt beside me blasting now on his MG-34 at any who jumped clear, and together we defended that corner of Russia on behalf of the Reich. I brought the panzer to a halt facing the ditch at an angle that gave me a good view of our comrade Tiger on the left. He was surrounded by dead and crushed Red infantry also, and he began to elevate his gun to take aim again at the Russian bunkers. I saw one of the dead Russians, apparently a blood-covered body, suddenly shake, crawl to his knees, and throw a bomb onto our fellow panzer. Kurt shot him down with his MG, and for safety he machine-gunned the other bodies lying nearby. But that one small Russian bomb did its terrible work. It landed on our fellow Tiger's back decking, where the engine fans spin under their armoured grills, and I saw a flash of orange flame as its charge ignited. A simple Molotov, just a glass bottle of cheap kerosene and a percussion fuse, but enough to send a litre of burning liquid down into the Tiger's mighty Maybach Engine. Hellman cursed, and I heard him kick at the turret cage with his polished boots, but his anger could do nothing against the flames that were rising from the Tiger on our left. A spiral of flame shot up out of that Tiger's engine, accompanied by debris from the engine, and one of the grills lifted off and span into the air. I saw the round hatch in the rear of the turret open, and the loader leaned out with an extinguisher, but the device spluttered and died in his hands. He threw it away, and the Tiger's other hatches opened as the crew began to evacuate before their fuel exploded. Of the five men who exited, four were immediately cut down by Red small arms fire. The fifth fell onto the burning grillies and lay there thrashing in the flames as the gasoline took hold below him. I looked to see where those murderous bullets came from. I saw, on the T-34 that was knocked out on the very edge of the anti-tank ditch, one of the Russian tank crew, still in his ribbed helmet, crouching behind the turret with its slumped gun barrel, aiming a machine pistol over the turret roof. Even out of the tank, these Red crews were determined to frustrate us and to cut us down. Kurt sprayed the man with MG-34, and the fellow tumbled off his tank, his MP still firing into the air. Suddenly, light and fresh air flooded down into our compartment, and I knew that Hellman had slid open his cupola hatch in the turret. "Take us close to the burning Tiger," he ordered me, and without asking why, I drove us the 20 meters over to the blazing vehicle, with its dead crew sprawled on its hull. Not all were dead, though. The man who had fallen onto the engine deck was still alive, flailing and twisting in the flames that slowly engulfed him from the burning Maybach engine under the grills. When I halted our panzer, I heard two shots from our cupola, and the burning man ceased his tormented movements and lay still in the flames. That was a mercy. I shook my head and waited for Hellman's orders. I could hear him rotating in the cupola, looking for some way over the anti-tank ditch. The other Tigers were poised all along our line, expectant, static targets that needed to be moving forward, not sitting still on the open step. It was down to us to lead the way across here and spearhead the victory that was so close. "There is a way across," Hellman said. "There is a causeway that the T-34s must have used. Advance to the edge, driver, and you will see." I spanned the panzer and drove up to the edge of the ditch. Yes, there was a narrow causeway over the anti-tank ditch, an earth ridge, barely wide enough for a Tiger to pass, but it looked solid and capable of taking our weight. After all, it had just taken the weight of a dozen T-34s that came charging out to meet us, T-34s which now lay burning in our wake. This might enable us to cross over to our final objective of the bunker line itself. "I'll drive over it then, sir," I said to Hellman on the intercom. "Ja," Kurt mimicked me. "We'll be in Moscow for schnapps time." "No," Hellman snapped. "It will be mined for sure, or there will be a bomb concealed. One of those Reds will be hidden here, waiting to blow it as soon as a panzer advances." "Then what?" I mouthed to Kurt. He shrugged. "Depress the gun elevation," Hellman said to our gunner. "Shoot into the causeway, use high explosive."
"Shoot the causeway, Herr Ober," the gunner repeated. "You heard me."
The gun system whined as the long 88mm declined to below horizontal, its massive barrel now visible in front of me. A moment later the gun barked. The smoke from the muzzle brake spiralled around and clouded my view, but a second later I saw the entire causeway explode. My God, the blast! That wasn't just an 88mm high explosive round. That was a concealed munition hidden somewhere inside the earth bridge and detonated by our shell. The entire causeway lifted into the air, and big pieces of rock and stone went spinning away, left and right, for hundreds of metres. Our whole Tiger shook in the blast wave. Chunks of debris rained down on us, clanging on the steel roof and pulverising the massed Russian bodies around us even further. A huge clod of earth splattered onto my vision port, obscuring my view completely. "That has proved my point," Hellman commented. "I'd say that was a crate of howitzer shells, primed and waiting to go up." "I'm blind, sir," I said. "You or the Panzer?" "The vision block, sir. It's covered in earth." "Get out and clean it, man. Be quick. And take a look at the ditch while you're there, Faust. Can we cross it?" I knew better than to query an order from Hellman, above all with our massed column of angry tigers behind us, itching to get moving over the obstacle. I opened the hatch above me and clambered out onto the hull top. Cold air and the smell of explosive hit me immediately as I leaned forward and pushed the earth away from the glass vision block under its steel eyelid. I looked around. The sight was astonishing. There were mangled Russian bodies everywhere. The causeway was utterly demolished, being now just a pile of rubble and earth inside the ditch, which was far too deep for us to drive across. Beyond it, the shattered bunkers lay drifting with smoke from the Stuka bombs, strangely inactive in the mist, still clinging to the ground. I climbed back inside the Panzer and slammed the hatch.
"Well," Hellman demanded, "can we cross over?"
"It's too deep now, sir. We'll need a bridging unit, or we need construction troops to fill it in."
"No, we must cross. We must cross now. The boss is gone, and we are the leading Panzer."
"We'll get stuck, sir."
"Use that T-34, Hellman ordered. "The one on the edge of the ditch, make use of him."
I felt Hellman's boot give me a sharp kick between the shoulder blades as I hesitated. He liked to hang down by his arms from the turret and kick me or Kurt in this manner, if he thought we were being slow.
"Do it, Faust, ram that T-34 into the ditch."
I could see what he meant us to do, but the risk was enormous. The wrecked T-34 that had sought to defy us on the edge of the ditch, whose crewman had shot our people as their Tiger burned. That tank was still in place, its tracks blown off by our shooting and by the blast from the causeway bomb, but still a big lump of Soviet iron that could fill a hole in the ground. I manoeuvred our Tiger up to its shattered hull, aware that all the Tiger crews behind me were watching my performance, and those handsome boys would not forgive a mistake. I put my glacis plate up to the sloped front of the T-34 and felt the resistance as our 600 horsepower pushed on the Russian's static weight in the mud. I cursed, engaged lowest gear, and pushed again. My whole vision block was filled with the front plate of the T-34, with its smashed driver's port and wrecked front drive wheels. The Russian machine began to slide back in the mud, slowly but clearly, a metre at a time, towards the ditch. I saw the hatch on the front deck of the T-34 open. A pale, confused face appeared in the gap, covered in blood. This Russian crewman stared at me through my glass block, blinking as he apparently regained consciousness, unable to believe what he was witnessing. I kept pushing his tank back with our nose, with this man looking me in the eyes from barely 4 meters distance. He seemed to realize where he was and what was happening, because he began to struggle, trying to pull himself out of the hatch as his tank started to tip back into the ditch behind. The Russian lad mouthed a few words, then opened his mouth and screamed as the whole T-34 slid down, tail first, into the ditch, and disappeared from view as it came to rest upside down, on the piles of rubble in the pit.
"Good," Hellman observed, the highest compliment he ever awarded.
"The Red is lying crosswise in the ditch, filling it for us. Drive over him, Faust."
"Yes, sir."
Beside me, Kurt seized hold of the hand grabs, knowing from experience what crossing a filled-in ditch was like. Using the steering control, though, I had nothing else to cling on to. As I took the Tiger forward, our great armoured nose tipped down and crashed into the pit. I saw the T-34's belly plate below us on the remains of the causeway, filling up the lower 3 meters of the hole, and in a moment our tracks crashed onto his deck. I lost a tooth as the impact shook my skull, and I felt the T-34 sink as our weight hit him. But our momentum was such that, with a blast of throttle that had the transmission spitting oil at me, our tracks got traction and our front hull clawed up and over the opposite bank of the ditch. Spitting blood and tooth fragments, I brought our Tiger thumping down onto the bunker side, the torsion bar suspension rods howling in protest, although I knew that they secretly enjoyed a little rough treatment. "Good," Hellman said again. "Gut," Kurt muttered to me. "You'll be Reich Inspector of Panzer Forces at this rate." "The Tigers are crossing behind us," Hellman said proudly. From his cupola, he had all-round vision, whereas I could only see in front of me. "Two panzers are across behind us, and now three." He chuckled his weird little laugh. "Now keep moving, driver. Don't remain a static target. Let's clear out these rat's nests, and then the place is ours." I drove over to the wreckage of the nearest bunker. This was a wide, squat concrete box with slit embrasures, in which the barrels of wrecked PAK guns pointed at crazy angles, crushed by the blown-in roof. As we approached, I saw flashes from inside, and I heard the faint jangle of small arms fire hitting our armour plate. One bullet clipped the edge of my vision block and cracked it with a long split. Our gunner immediately lowered the 88mm and fired 3 rounds of high explosive into the remains of the bunker's apertures. The bunker walls collapsed, and the structure slumped into dust, together with whoever was determined to hold out inside of there for his mother Russia. Out from the back end of the wreckage, a handful of ragged individuals emerged, their quilted jackets thick with soot and smoking from the blast. They raised their hands and swayed on their feet, staring up at us. Kurt shot them down with 1 second from his MG, and then muttered to himself as he changed his magazines again. The Russians lay in front of us on the ice, breathing their last. "Now we spread out and secure the zone for our panzer grenadiers," Hellman said, and he began talking on the intercom to other tank commanders, with Kurt, as the radio operator, patching him through to them with his valve set. 5 minutes later, we seemed to be in complete control. Hellman, as acting commander of our unit, was trying to contact our divisional command by radio to inform them of our success. This was an uncertain process, though, as our radio set was not the boss's high-capacity unit. Ours was designed only for contact between tanks, not over long distances. While that went on, I was given permission to exit the panzer and check the running gear and wheels for damage. I climbed up onto the hull and took in the scene of our victory. All along the sloping ground beyond the bunkers, our Tigers were climbing to the ridge at the top, taking up their commanding fire position that would guard the main thrust of our Kampfgruppe battle group through the centre of the Soviet lines, 10 kilometres to the south. That was the plan, and the plan was working so far. I checked our track links and dish wheels, finding them in good order, although the links would need tightening and the rear idler wheels were bleeding lubricant. The tracks were coated in bits of human debris from our clash with the Red Infantry before the ditch, hair, boots, fingers, and long bloody shreds of flesh. Cleaning this stuff out was a miserable job that we usually allocated to prisoners. Indeed, huddled against a bunker nearby was a sad group of 10 live Russians whose surrender we had accepted, as they appeared to be part of a radio operating team. A radio team was a good catch, and they might hold useful intelligence. But, like all prisoners, they would be put to work cleaning our track links and doing whatever lifting and carrying we needed before they were taken away for processing. One of these prisoners in particular attracted our men's attention. She was a young woman, apparently some kind of junior radio officer, that we wanted to prioritise for interrogation because of her rank and her potential knowledge. She stood there scowling, with her arms folded across the front of her male uniform, her hair in coppery coils around her neck. Behind us, the anti-tank ditch was properly bridged now. A Sturmpione engineer's unit had come up with a steel gantry bridge on a panzer file chassis and slung it across the chasm, away from the wrecked causeway and the crushed T-34 that we had used as an emergency filler. Our supporting panzer grenadier infantry had caught up with us, and were crossing the steel bridge in their Hanomag half-tracked vehicles, then fanning out across the land behind the Tigers, so that we were a true little occupying army up here on the Russian heights. Some of the Hanomag troops yelled at me as their half-track paused nearby. "Who dumped the Ivan in the ditch, Faust?" "I did it myself." "Scheisse. You learnt a lot when your daddy was driving that tram, didn't you?" I gave them a cheerful underarm salute, and they returned it as their vehicle drove on up the ridge. "But yes," I thought, looking at a mangled Russian belt buckle wedged in my front drive wheel. "I learned a lot from my daddy driving that tram, when I was sitting on his knee and hearing stories of the First War.